Frank, I was going to ask if you have seen the Dreamcast Propeller Arena, quote, official release.
What do you mean by that?
Propeller Arena is a game that did not come out.
It didn't come out. Are you talking about, like, copies that were printed at the time and not sold?
No, copies that were printed, like, older games style. Like, someone was like, we can make copies of this now.
No.
There was, like, a run of those that happened for a while.
Interesting.
I just got one, and it is incredibly charming because it's all, like, printed on someone's printer with some cardstock, and then the inside is regular printer paper, but it's been stapled together and they've put high quality tape on the end so that it can be double sided. It's like a zine, basically, and it's really cute. and at the end it says, "Have fun, Gary Walton, 27/12/03. 2003 was when Gary Walton put this in there.
Is that when he had fun?
Yeah.
That's when he wanted me to have fun.
Oh, okay. So he did not have fun then.
No, he didn't do it.
Okay.
I don't think.
Danger is lurking around every edit. Trust your feelings. Got to insert credit. This is episode 191 of the Insert Credit Hour, a program where a panel of experts has no choice but to answer every inane question I ask them for 6 minutes each. If they come up with too many interesting things to say about it, they'll be punished for going over time by the sound of a horrible buzzer. I'm Alex Jaffe, and if I could select one beverage to be my personal video game health potion, at this point it would probably be Triple X Vitamin Water.
Oh, my name is Frank Spaldi, and if I could choose one beverage to be my personal video game potion, did I word that correctly?
That's good enough.
Black coffee. Sure. That's okay. Besides water, that is my number one beverage.
I was kind of vacillating between water and something else myself. I'm Brandon Sheffield. My video game potion thingy, oh, I know what it would be, is the discontinued AHA brand flavored sparkling water thing, which was apple ginger. That was the best flavor, and it's all gone now. They should put more ginger in stuff, god darn it.
You know whose health potion is water? Mario in Super Mario 64. Dive in, and when you come up, your health's all back.
And it's not because he died?
No, not because
Hello!
He died. Oh, hey.
My name is Liz.
I was getting to you, okay?
Gosh dang it. Okay, fine. I wanted to have a nice... Okay, go ahead. No, you go
All
ahead.
Right, joining us this week, it's insert credit friend of the show, Liz Ryerson.
Hello, my name is Liz Ryerson, and if I had to drink one beverage as a health potion in a video game, it would be Sencha green tea, because I drink that all the time.
That's a good one.
All right. Yeah, we're all choosing the thing which would least alter our lifestyle, I suppose. So the way this goes at this point is where I inform you that I keep a secret tally of how well everyone does over the course of the show, and I decide a winner based on everyone's responses at the end. And the prize for winning is that you get to come up with a question for the next episode. Last week's winner was Frank, which also meant that last week's winner was guest of the show, Kelsey, who was there specifically to take the win from him, should he succeed. So Kelsey submitted a question to me right before the show. Kelsey asked, Frank has talked about his idea of a recipe show for the best ways to experience old games. What is the recipe for the worst way to play Super Mario Brothers?
This isn't like pairings. This is how to set up your life and your experience or whatever.
Yeah.
My concept for a recipe show for games is essentially like, here's how to play this game. That's approached from multiple angles in my head. Some of it's technical, right? It's like, well, if you're playing Super Mario Brothers, it's like, if you're a lawyer angel or whatever and need to play it legally, here's this way. But if you don't care, is this way, and I recommend turning off the sprite limitation thing on your emulator for this reason, blah blah blah. That's part of it. And then the other way is like how to approach a game mentally to like actually understand a game. So I would consider that sort of a recipe for playing an old game, you know, teaching people how to play properly. So what's the worst way for Super Mario Brothers is the question.
I've already got a few things in my mind, which is like stretched into 69 on a like a crappy plug-and-play TV Famiclone with a bad controller. That's where I would start.
Just constantly point out, say, How many drugs were they smoking when they came up with this?
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Mushrooms. I've heard of those. That's what the bad kids ate.
Just like the hackest of hack comedy attempts, like while they're playing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
I think you're right, Brandon. I think it is. It doesn't have to be a plug and play, but it should be like composite on your TV stretched.
Yeah, stretched.
The most convenient way to play Super Mario.
Although composite is maybe good.
Well, no, on your modern television, it's probably going to interpret that 240p signal as 480i and start smearing stuff.
Yeah, so, okay, got it.
Well, and make sure that they like make a big deal about the fact that they're playing it on the original console, and that's what it's supposed to look like.
Yes, there you go. You nailed it. That's not a plug and play. It's a real NES, a real cartridge, not the one with Duck Hunt, because you don't want to be tempted. And it's played in 16:9 with motion smoothing on.
But I want a bad controller to be in the mix. So,
okay. What was it called? The Advantage?
Yeah.
Is that the one that's like that dial thing?
Yeah, with the weird octagon on it.
Yeah, there's the NES Max too, but that was an okay controller.
Was the Max the joystick?
No, I don't think.
Oh, wait, yeah, you're talking about the one that had like it just sort of like looped around in a little circle.
NES Max looks like a boomerang.
Yeah, that disc.
Oh, I am thinking of the NES Max. So play it on the NES Max.
Is that worse than the Power Glove?
Well, now it's just getting silly, right? Like, that's not believable anymore.
All right.
But they could be wearing a Power Glove on their other arm.
It doesn't have to be believable. I mean, we're setting up this scenario for someone.
Well, then you get stupid. Then it's like, okay, a dance pad.
You know? No dance pad. But they should just be talking about like the most like bog standard hack things, like observations, like, oh, I was so nostalgic over this.
Yes.
Like mushrooms, what were they thinking? Like just every possible hack observation that you could make that everyone's made on every single like channel, and they're even saying things wrong. They're like, you know, giving information that sounds like it's correct, but it's actually wrong.
Yeah.
What if instead of having them play Super Mario Brothers, you had them play a one-to-one recreation of Super Mario Brothers in Super Mario Maker, where all the physics are different and you can put in a bunch of obnoxious sound effects?
I think that would be too funny.
Yeah, maybe.
I think you can make a case for the Power Glove, because you could be like, just like in The Wizard, and people would be like, whoa, dude.
Right. And the Power Glove was marketed specifically as a way to play games, whereas a dance pad is kind of an abstraction.
Yeah. Maybe player two is on the Power Glove, and you have to fight over who gets to...
Who's got the power.
Yeah. Mario is the NES Max, and Luigi's on the Power Glove.
Yeah. And then also, it should be on a boat that's on fire.
Sure.
Oh, and maybe one of your controllers is the one with the slow motion feature that just pauses and unpauses really fast.
I love that.
We recommend that for newcomers to play the game.
Slow motion was like a Game Genie cheat in so many of those NES Game Genie books. Even as a kid, I figured it out pretty fast. I was like, oh, man, just got down there just pausing it.
Wait, the Game Genie code is pausing, unpausing the game?
It was, yeah. It was like
that's bizarre.
Slow motion, because you know they'd have like extra infinite lives, infinite health, and whatever, and then they'd be like slow motion.
Oh, I didn't even know you could do that. That's neat.
You could have them spend like 20 minutes trying to do a wall jump because they think that they're going to speed run the game, and they saw it on a video one time. They're like, dude, I'm going to wall jump right now. This is more important than anything else. Like right in the middle.
So you teach people that one of the most important things to playing Super Mario Brothers is mastering the wall jump.
Yeah. Yes. Make sure you can land on like the pixel next to a piranha plant.
Yeah. Yeah. I like that. Okay.
That's pretty good. All right. Has a spiritual sequel to a popular game ever surpassed it?
Probably.
Yeah, I don't know that I've actually played any of those.
Like, Axiom Verge is a Metroid spiritual sequel, in a way. And
No, it's just the genre. I think Bloodstained is the spiritual sequel.
Yes.
I guess. Okay.
I think for a game to be a spiritual sequel, the same developers have to be involved.
Is Death Stranding the spiritual sequel to Metal Gear?
I would say yes.
Yes.
What about Dark Souls and fuck is it
Dank
called?
Souls?
The PS1 games.
Kingsfield.
Yeah. Does that count?
Yeah, I'd count.
I think
that.
That
but
counts.
I don't think the Kingsfield games count as popular.
Japan, they do. They made like eight of them or something. That many, but yeah, they made a bunch of those things.
At least
I think
four.
That kind of counts. I guess Siren is a spiritual sequel to the Silent Hill some of the Silent Hill games, but it's not, I don't like it as much.
If we're going, you know, like point and click adventure stuff, I think Thimbleweed Park is better than Maniac Mansion and Zack McCracken.
Sure.
Just because, you know, 30 years of game design evolution has taught us much when it comes to that style of adventure game.
Rather than just kind of listing the games, what about these spiritual sequels improve from the original material?
Well, I think the Thimbleweed Park that Frank just mentioned, it's like a reimagining by a lot of the same people in a more like modern particular outside of the context of like the, you know, typical decisions made in those genres. So it's like redesigned with a few decades of perspective in mind. And a game like that doesn't really lose the tone of the original, because, you know, sometimes they might lose something in translation. But that's a good example of like, we're just going to take what worked about that and like reimagine it and, you know, make essentially a version of that, but is easy to get into for somebody who isn't, you know, as used to navigating those old, you know, tropes or whatever.
Yeah, I think that's spot on for that game. The easiest thing to point to is there's no way to get stuck, which you could in Zack and Maniac. But in a lot of ways, I also think Thimbleweed is sort of a spiritual successor to Monkey Island, so maybe that doesn't count.
You know, I also realized that somebody, in fact, two people we were talking about last episode are a good candidate for this. Like that Darkside Toshi fella who did Psycho Fox and Decap Attack and Magical Hat, Turbo, etc. Like, each one of those is a spiritual sequel to the prior one. Yeah. And each one of them is just doing the same thing a little bit better. It's like, okay, I have this weird mechanic idea, and I'm just going to do better level design and make it feel better every time. I think that works pretty well. And then also that, I still don't remember what it's called, the one that's not Legendary Axe, but is on the NES.
Astyan X?
Yeah, Astyan X. Whichever one's a spiritual sequel of the other. I forget which one came first.
Are these the new games that we talk about every episode now? Is that the new trope?
I hope so.
I played through all of Astyan X or whatever. That game is, I wouldn't call it great, but it's not bad. I assume that that's probably the prototype version of whatever the spiritual sequel was.
Legendary Axe.
Yeah, I imagine that was before, because, yeah, Astyan X is some like really grindy bits from what I recall.
There's a bootleg of Astyan X that's an Aladdin game, and it's not a very good fit. Wow, just killed the room with that one.
I was trying to envision it.
I can't imagine that it would be. It's no Magic of Scheherazade.
There you go.
Nothing is.
No.
I want to play that. Let's just stop the show.
All right. Magic of Scheherazade.
Scheherazade.
That's the name. Here's our third question.
It's a quest about sharing.
Wait, yeah, I just need Scheherazade. I can't figure out which of these games came first, Astyan X or Legendary Axe, because they both came out. Oh man, they both came out in 89 in Japan. I guess it. Yeah,
they're both,
I guess,
home games, right? So they have specific dates. So you could probably figure this out.
Yeah, I think Astyan X came out a couple months before Legendary Axe, except it came out later in the U.S.
All right, here's our third question. So Sonic the Hedgehog celebrated its 30th anniversary this week with a crowd-pleasing combination Philharmonic rock concert. How would you commemorate a game series landmark anniversary if you had no new games to show them?
Oh, you mean like they did?
Yeah, exactly.
I guess I'd probably do something similar. Apparently, a friend of the show, Ash Parrish, liked it so much that it made her cry. He was curious because it really should have been for me. Because I love Sonic, I love listening to music, but I found that the symphonic arrangements were just like, it just made me want to listen to the real thing. They just were like slower and weirder, you know, but not in a way that...
Yeah, but you can listen to the real thing any day.
That's what it made me want to do. It just didn't do it for me. And then you get to the second half where it's all the pop punk extreme Sonic stuff, and it's like, it's great that it's straight going for it. But it was so goofy. I don't know. I was happy that other people liked it. It was my final conclusion.
I was happy that some people cried.
This would be the perfect solution. Do like a 2-hour documentary where you just interview a lot of people from the fan community, and you like surprise them all with, you know, one of the creators of the game, and they come in and they like give them a hug and, you know, film them like sobbing is like, oh my God, I love your game or whatever. And then you can like do 20 minutes or whatever of the music tributes at the end and just make it a tribute to the fan community, which is what something like Sonic could do, because that's like what has kept that game alive.
Right.
It does sound like what they would do.
Yeah.
I like that. I think it's really easy to default into celebrating the games and their creators. But when you're celebrating decades of something being beloved, then I think what you're celebrating is the lovers. So, right. Yeah, I'm into that.
Tell you what I would have done, which would not really happen.
You'd have Yasuhara say, "I hate you," and leave.
Yeah, I'd have him say, "This is why
none of you are free of sin.
I made this to hurt you.
If I could take it all back, I would."
I would interview a bunch of people from it, but I would have them show, like, Yasuhara hasn't showed most of his sketches publicly. Yeah. So I would be like showing the early stuff. I would have Yuji Naka talk about assembly coding. I would get the Traveler's Tales guy, John Burton, to talk about all the wacky Saturn secrets and stuff. Just like have it be a huge like history of development of Sonic, which I think would be super fascinating. And then maybe
It would also be like 40 hours long though, yeah, because there's a lot of game.
Yeah,
and
I'm ready.
What are you gonna pick?
40 hours long. No, I mean I'd pick like Sonic 1 and maybe Sonic.
You're talking about 3. Traveler's Tale, so you got like 3D Blast in here, I guess.
Yeah, maybe 3D Blast, maybe and Sonic R.
Obviously you would need Sonic and the Black Knight, so.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's important. Yeah. That's a big
one. I want the people who made like the popcorn machine.
Sure. The BioWare RPG.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But I do seriously think if it were me, I would take the opportunity to try to show, if I don't have anything new to show, I would show more old stuff that people don't know about that they would like, because it's a celebration of history, 30 years. So I would want to showcase what that history was.
I don't know if this counts as a new game, but I've always wanted to just, you know, the stuff we did at Digital Eclipse, the bonus gallery stuff, I want to just ship those as products without the games. So maybe I would do that for something like a Sonic, just release like a free marketing app that's just essentially the cool part of Sonic Jam, but updated.
Yeah, that would be really good. I would be into it.
They should also release a full uncut version of Topher Florence's Sonic 2 Special Edition Let's Play in HD.
Well, yeah, like canonize it, right? Like,
yes.
Give it the official Sega blessing. Yeah, I like that.
I don't know, because that might create a conflict of interest later when we get Nintendo to license his official Funky Kong game.
Yeah, well, he's playing both sides. You know, that's what you have to do. You have to be an enterprising business person to make it in this industry. And I think that's what Absolutely. We need to celebrate.
I would have had Charles Martinet narrate.
That's the host of your documentary.
Yeah, hosting Sonic. It's him.
All right, here's my next question. Are you ready for this next question?
Yeah, but really quick, I want to say that he doesn't do the Mario voice, and he never acknowledges that he has anything to do with Mario. It's just, I'm your host, Charles Martinet.
No, of course.
Let's celebrate Sonic the Hedgehog.
He did that for like the Bit Trip Runner ads. He's like, "Hi, I'm Charles Martinet," and never acknowledged that he's the Mario guy. It's pretty good. Can listening to a game soundtrack before playing it be considered a spoiler?
No.
Next question.
Okay.
No, you don't have enough context. I mean, generally. I don't know. I listened to Earthbound's soundtrack a ton before I actually played the game. I had heard of the game for a long time, but I never played it until after I listened to the soundtrack, and the soundtrack is actually what got me interested in playing the game.
I've had that experience myself, specifically with Chrono Cross and Chrono Trigger, actually. I listened to the Chrono Trigger music before playing Chrono Trigger and the Chrono Cross music before playing Chrono Cross, and while you can get the experience of, you know, say you played the game and then you get the soundtrack 20 years later, you're like, "Oh, I remember that time." But you can also sort of get the inverse thing by, I listened to that Chrono Cross soundtrack so much in college without playing the game because I just really liked it. And then playing the game, getting like much more slowly getting to each new song in the soundtrack, it just kept bouncing me through various emotional terrains because that music was so important to me at a certain time that having it be revealed really slowly in the game was like an anti-spoiler. It was like an emotional reveal over time, which is really cool.
I have a yes answer to the question, which is Sonic Mania. When Sonic Mania came out, we didn't know what all the levels were, and half of the levels are like throwback levels.
All right. Mm-hmm.
If that's the kind of thing you'd consider a spoiler, like the return of Hydro City Zone or something.
Yeah.
And you listen to the soundtrack before you played, you would go, "Oh, that's Hydro City Zone. There's going to be Hydro City Zone in this game." That's a spoiler.
I would say if you were a really big fan of Homestuck, there's a spoiler in the Undertale soundtrack if you listen to that before you play the game.
A spoiler for Homestuck?
No, a spoiler that song, there's a popular song from that multimedia comic which reappears in the game, and it's supposed to be a big surprise.
Yeah, because Toby Fox did music for Homestuck, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess like song titles could be spoilers, so I guess that would be the biggest thing.
Oh yeah, Amy's funeral from Sonic Mania.
Yeah,
a really big one. Yeah.
If you disabled the song titles, though, like you just the music itself, I don't know. I don't think it ruins the experience. I mean, it could ruin a few things, but you never know like what the context actually is going to be until you play the thing.
But like, you know what a boss theme sounds like. So if you're halfway through playing the game and you hear all the boss fights on the soundtrack and there are a few that you haven't heard yet, you're like, oh, there's some more bosses coming, aren't there?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's a spoiler, but I don't think it's much of a spoiler because it's like, okay, I'm not great at this shooter and I've only gotten to stage 5 and I listen to the soundtrack and it's like, oh, stage 8. Uh-oh. It's going to be a stage 8.
Sounds rough.
I think it can be a spoiler, but I don't think it matters. I don't think it can spoil anything in a way that hurts your experience particularly. And like even with the Homestuck thing, by the way, I don't think I'll ever know what Homestuck is.
That's fine.
Say you are a fan of that, you would probably get excited about it. I don't think it's going to spoil you in a way that it negatively affects your experience. It might make you anticipate something more.
Maybe.
You're speaking from the perspective of someone who probably does not become enraged by being quote unquote spoiled, like I'm sure all of us in this room.
Oh,
actually.
Sure. Yeah.
So I'm trying to approach it from the perspective of someone who actually like gets upset when minor things get spoiled.
Well, sure. Like you can't name a Star Wars song anything because then someone will be like, no, it's not right.
Yeah, like emergence of the Empire. No,
now I know the Empire emerges.
They sound like a cranky like 80, 85 year old Star Wars fan.
Yeah.
No, how could you?
They see the song title Han Solo is my dad, and they're like, oh, but who's my dad?
Are you sure that isn't horny people on the internet who are saying that?
I'm not sure who it is.
Now, I have a friend who will never listen to a game soundtrack until he plays the entire game through, because his reasoning is that every one of those tracks is written with a particular emotional resonance in mind with that scene. And if you play it before that, then you're getting the wrong intention out of the piece.
Interesting. He should learn about how game development works and then throw all that out the window.
Yeah, here's a bunch of tracks. Could this fit here?
Like 90% of songs composed by Tim Fallon, for example, I don't think he played the games. I think he just did whatever he wanted. And there are plenty of examples of that. Or even in the best case, like maybe they barely played it or only have a vague idea of what it's supposed to be.
They had read a Silver Surfer comic before. Yeah.
I think he captured the true spirit of Pictionary.
Yeah, the emotional resonance of that Pictionary title screen is really important.
Exactly. So this is our last episode that will come out in Pride Month. So I think this is a good opportunity to talk about the embarrassing ways that video games have failed the queer community as an example of what never to do again.
Uh-oh.
Oh, God, I don't want to encourage you to talk about Nier again, but wasn't there a really gross like trophy in this remake?
Oh, no. No, let's not talk about that, please.
Okay.
I don't even know about that. Are trophies spoilers?
Let's not get near that issue.
Whoa.
There's a horrible trophy in the remake of Nier that wasn't in the original that you get for like trying to look up Kainé's skirt. It's gross.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Well, that sucks.
It really does.
That's too bad. There's a lot of Japanese games out there where they had some rough times. I mean, we love Deadly Premonition on this show, but I don't know if he's even supposed to be a gay stereotype, but he's a stereotype of something.
He's cross-dresser of in some capacity. Something.
Yeah. I mean, I know Swery has really, he's really tried to swing fully back the other direction from there, but there's so much of it. I mean, even when people are trying to do good, sometimes they do ill.
Yeah, but like, there's a difference between people who are trying and people who are clearly not.
Yeah, well, like the character in Streets of Rage 3 who got cut from Bare Knuckle 3, who's just like
Poison.
No, it's this leather Poison's in Final Fight.
Because isn't Poison supposed to be trans too?
Poison is trans, but I don't think Poison I think poison was is like treated the best of basically everybody, because poison is just like it's referenced in such passing as to be like a non-issue. It's just like,
I see,
you know, they didn't have the language to just say poison is trans and move on. But
unlike Nintendo's cruel treatment of Birdo, which is,
yeah, she says she wants to be called Birdetta, let's just call her Birdetta.
Yeah, poison was actually a pretty good example. I think poison has never been made a big deal out of, and I think that's pretty cool. Yeah, the Streets of Rage 3 one was just like a prancing, mincing leather daddy who has a high voice and is punching with foxy boxy gloves and stuff. It's just, I don't know, it's really, I think that the Yakuza translation team has done an excellent job of trying to smooth over a lot of that stuff, but you know, like the Earth Angel bar has always got some, you know, I guess cross-dressing person or trans person who has like a huge amount of stubble, who's like, hey hun, how's it going? And it's just, I feel like they're trying, but they just don't understand how to try. It's really disappointing because I love that series.
I wonder how much of that stuff is cultural. I mean, not to say that, like, probably so many like 90s point and click adventure games in particular that have like trans or gay panic jokes in them. It just seems like the perfect time and place for that to have happened.
Or right, because it's a game about like people who talk, right? And right. It's all dudes, many of them in the United Kingdom. So yeah, there's probably some really
gross
stuff.
There's definitely a lot of gay panic jokes in there.
Leisure Suit Larry.
There was a huge amount of it in like comedy movies in general, like in the 90s, like early 90s, because of like the Crying Game and stuff like that. I don't know tons about it, but I felt like I couldn't take a step without hearing someone upset about an Atlus game, especially like about, I don't know, 8 or 9 years ago. They seem to be notoriously bad for that. I don't really know much about it. I'm not like an expert, especially when it comes to like representation in those kinds of games, but it seemed like they were always, we'll say, at the bottom of the barrel.
Yeah, they were putting their foot in it. I didn't actually see the thing, but as I recall with Catherine, they had a character who was trans, and then the main character finds out and gets grossed out and stuff. And it's like, just like,
not great.
I don't know. Keep your biases and your proclivities to yourself. I think the thing that's most insulting is it's presented as a universal, like a universal idea that this is how everyone would feel if they found out that someone was trans or whatever. And it's so disappointing.
Yeah. I mean, that was a very common thing in media. Like, you know, you ever watch the TV show Friends or like Family Guy has a joke where like the dog dates a trans woman and then he finds out and he vomits on camera for like 2 minutes straight, you know. Unfortunately, it's very common, or it has been very common in the past.
Yeah,
it's now frowned upon more. But
I guess the main thing I wanted to ask is, do you think that Grand Theft Auto 6 will cut down on this or double down?
I bet they will be like self-aware about it and be like, this character isn't good, and so that's why they use slurs all the time.
They're allowed to get the Tarantino loophole.
Yeah,
they'll probably do both. I feel like it's of character to like do both. It's like, well, we have positive representation in some ways, but we have very negative in other ways. It's weird because like Saints Row is like, you know, explicitly more like sordid and goofy and like whatever, but it seems to do much better with that kind of stuff in general, even though it's like the quote-unquote trashy version.
Yeah, Saints Row 3, where you could have the giant purple dildo and wave it around and whatever.
Right. It's better just by dint of letting you be that without making jokes about it.
Yeah.
Video games seem to be like, there isn't as much oversight as there is like in Hollywood or whatever. It's easier to just sort of drip out the result of straight white men being super obsessed with anything that's different from themselves and just needing to talk about it, needing to be like, this is what I think about gay people and how it's gross. Video games just seem to be the dumping ground for people like me, I guess.
It's the unfiltered id. That guy at E3, the Razer guy, he did like a presentation like on Razer's gaming products. It was the most unhinged thing I've ever seen. Apparently, he's a terrible boss, according to interviews or a piece that got run in Kotaku at some point. But it was the most like gaming aesthetic kind of thing ever. And I found it to be wonderful theater, but it was also terrifying. That really represented what it is. And yeah, there's this unfiltered id, like the end, and it comes down to like you enacting a certain kind of fantasy or empowerment in a very particular unfiltered way.
Yeah, and it's kind of this like, I just thought about gay people for the first time. This is my gut reaction to that.
Now I'm going to spend 3 years putting that gut reaction into a video game.
Exactly.
And not second guess it even once in that entire 36 month period.
It's like my gut reaction is definitely right, because right. I have been told my entire life that all my opinions are super valid and incredibly important. And so nobody else would have thought what I think, which is that this is icky to me.
Yeah.
The people need to know.
I mean, in a way, there's a thing I like about video games, and that it is kind of unfiltered and ugly in the stereotype way. Like, I obviously am really into Doom, and that is like a very unfiltered and ugly game, but it's also not really offensive unless you're
right.
hyper-Christian, I guess. But even
unless you hate blood.
Yeah, or maybe if you're satanic, you don't like them killing demons.
Yeah, I love demons.
There's interesting territory to be mined there. And even with something like Catherine, you could say that theoretically, maybe if the game was being critical of its protagonist and his like obsessions,
right,
then it could do something with that. But obviously it's not. I don't want people to stray away from dealing with upsetting stuff. But the problem is because it's unfiltered, it's like goes unexamined, and there isn't it isn't thought about in a real conscious way.
Right. And I think it's even more disappointing that way because, you know, it's an opportunity and a platform to actually discuss things in ways that are more interesting than a lot of straight media, linear media, I mean. And when it's like, here's this opportunity to do something nuanced with this, and then they're just like, I'm going to have this dog throw out for 2 minutes is what I'm going to do. It's super disappointing.
All right. Well, we'll be right back after a quick break to talk about something a little lighter.
Nice.
Hey, remember when Charlie Daniels got mad at Guitar Hero 3 because they used his song for the boss fight against the devil, since he didn't want it to be possible for the devil to win?
No, but it's, I don't know who Charlie Daniels is, but that sounds fun.
He did The Devil Went Down to Georgia.
Oh.
Right, yeah. I did see an interview with Sandy Peterson, who worked on Doom, who's a Mormon, and he says some kind of bizarre and untrue things about Doom sometimes, or games that he worked on.
Oh yeah, John Romero loves to like stomp all over whatever Sandy's saying.
Yeah, it's not just Sandy, but also like guy who did some of the shareware levels. Someone asked him like, do you have a problem with, you know, working on this game with all this like satanic imagery? And he's like, well, no, because they're the bad guys.
Right.
Yeah. It's good stuff.
We now return to Insert Credit. It's time for us to go to the Dirt Bag. The Dirt Bag is the section of the podcast where every week I take one question submitted to us by our generous listeners.
One question.
at patreon.com/insertcredit, where subscribers at any level could get access to that question form. Regular episodes one day early.
One day early?
One day early!
Nice.
24 hours prior to the rest of the world. This week's question comes from MoxBagel, who asks, is there a way to design around players' tendency to save items until they need them, thus never using almost any items?
Oh, I had a big long think about this one recently, and I wound up removing items from the game, is what I did. But a little bit about my thought process was, I liked the idea of consumable items, but I didn't like the idea that you would hoard them until you needed them. So I was going to give you too many. Like, you would just get a whole bunch of them. And that didn't really work out.
No.
Because then they just sort of become nothing. And it's sort of like ammo in an FPS, where it's like, I know I'm going to get a bunch more of this, so I'm not going to worry about it too much. So then it sort of became a non-thing. And then I had this thought of, like, what if rather than single-use items, you had to work hard to get items that you could use forever. And that was sort of an okay idea, but it wound up not fully jiving with the rest of what I was doing, and so then I just got rid of items entirely. But it's like, if you craft the items, then it feels more likely that you might use them, because you crafted it because you need it, because you want to use it. Since you can craft it, it doesn't feel, it's not a drop, so it doesn't feel like maybe I won't see this again. So if you keep the materials for crafting plentiful, but make crafting a thing that you can only do from a certain place or a certain screen. You've resource limited it through like time or geographic location. So then you're like, yeah, I'm going to use these, but I'm going to go back and make some more later when I go back to this town hub. And I think that works pretty well.
You could make all of those items food that deteriorates.
Yeah, I was thinking about item shelf life. That, like, mm-hmm. if you sit on it too long.
Yeah, I was thinking about that as well, but I would go even further. Let's say the game is set in an alternate dimension, and you're, like, still, like, phasing in and out, like, a little bit between dimensions. And so, like, over time, things become, like, dimensionally compromised, and so they stop, like, existing, so they deteriorate. Mm-hmm. So you have, like, a... So like, let's say at the beginning, like when you you grab an item or something, it has like it has 100% chance of working. But if you've let it deteriorate, when you grab it, it might only have like a 30% chance of working, or it could just deteriorate totally. So that would tell you that you'd have to use it sooner or later. There'd probably be less annoying ways to do that. But I think that idea is really funny.
I like that idea. And also taking it one step further and having like items changing into other stuff as you're going back and forth between dimensions. It's like, oh, my health potion is now like a weird animal. What do I do with this? I would almost be into that as a whole mechanic where like you're vacillating between dimensions and like you're running an item shop and you're trying to maintain inventory and it's like too many tribbles all of a sudden.
Sometimes they turn into bees and just start attacking you.
Yeah, you just get weird nonsense going on, and every new customer brings their dimensional residue with them, and it messes with your inventory and stuff. Sorry, this is getting into a whole different direction, but...
No, I like it.
It got my brain going. Well, I'll make it later.
Okay, cool.
Interdimensional shopkeeper.
Yeah,
I like it.
Interdimensional shopkeeper. I'm going to call it, what are you buying?
They either have a shelf life, or there's some mechanic in the game that... makes them go away or become undesirable if you don't use them in a timely manner. So, you know, I think Liz's example is great. It'd be like if you're playing, I don't know, Link to the Past, and whenever you go between light and dark world, your inventory of consumables disappears, right? So you're just going to start using them because you can.
They did that in Majora's Mask, actually, that every time you time loop, you lose your perishables.
There you go. The answer was there all along.
These could deteriorate over time and perhaps end up back, like maybe there's a limited quantity and they end up back somewhere else in the, or something like that.
Well, now they're limited again, so I'm not going to use them.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure if I'm convinced.
Yeah, you have to be incentivized to use them maybe at a certain point in time where there's more benefit to use them.
You may get access to this sort of item again at some point. Like it's still limited, but... maybe in, you know, a few more time loops, you'll come back to that dimension and be able to get those sorts of items again or something like that.
Yeah, I like that.
You could just not make games.
That is one way to go.
That's a good way as well.
Yeah.
You could be in the not game making dimension instead of the game making dimension.
Yeah, like the vast majority of people will never have this problem. Why not join them?
Yeah.
That's true. I never considered that. I could
That's an option for a lot of these questions, really.
I don't have to deal with any of this at all.
Yeah.
You could just work in a sandwich shop. You know, I was thinking, if retail work paid a living wage, I'd work in a record shop still.
Like, are there those?
There are. There's some.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, I know.
They're cool.
Not tons, though.
I'm kind of vacillating between a few questions here.
Like dimensions.
Yes. If you don't like this one, I'll pick a different one. That's how
so we have veto power. For
yes,
this
you have
question.
Veto power for okay. this question. If every big tech company followed through on their threats to enter the video game market and they all developed their own consoles, which one would be the wildest disaster?
That's kind of fun, though.
Yeah, I thought
if all the big tech companies that have announced consoles, or are we just going to think
just
of
all of them?
Tech,
just all of them. So, like, Amazon's got one, Facebook's got one.
Okay, which one's the biggest disaster? Right.
Yeah.
It's a tough one because, you know, Amazon, all of them are going to be monitoring you all the time. So I don't know who's going to do it the worst. Maybe Amazon. Amazon's going to report you to the cops.
I think if like all these guys and I don't know what, like Verizon or something, like if everyone in the huge tech sector made a game console and like a game service to play the games on the game console, this is going to sound like a joke. I think Google does the worst.
Yeah.
I actually think that's, you know, the way that they've launched the Stadia is worse than any other tech company would have done.
Why do you think that happened?
Size of the company, just too many departments that don't talk to each other. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just,
yeah, there's definitely that stuff.
It seems Google has like a culture of just starting a billion things and then not really committing to them or supporting them adequately.
Right. This thing's already dead internally, I'm sure. They're not going to say that, but like, I'm sure that they've already splintered off a lot of the developers and like absorbed them into other teams and stuff. Like, I'm sure they've given up on this. Like, they give up on everything.
I'm not 100% sure that Amazon wouldn't do a worse job, because they did, for example, buy a branch of the CryEngine and do Lumberyard and then try to make that a thing, and just nobody's using it except for Amazon's internal teams. Like, nobody wants to use it. And that's like a really quiet failure in a way.
I guess when I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking in terms of them developing a platform that others deploy games on, not them making games. And maybe that's the wrong way of thinking, because Amazon Games Division, probably one of the worst disasters in terms of game development that's ever been.
I think the problem is like, if you're looking at something that they would adequately like want to invest in, there's something kind of boring or sordid or like not socially good enough about games in themselves. So they would have to make it be something like greater if they wanted to be like a consistent investment. So like, I'd imagine them having like a bunch of like wellness. It's like wellness apps like disguised as a game, or like, you know, just pivoting into making virtual reality apps for military contractors or things like surveillance technology or things like that. Like all of that stuff kind of, if it has consistent support and money behind it, and it doesn't end up being like a kind of a disaster, or it's something that has consistent investment, I just imagine it going into one of those things like surveillance technology, military technology, some kind of weird wellness app thing at best. So I don't know.
Totally. Some way to kill people outside of this country and or commit multi-level marketing schemes. Like, if we think about who would do the grossest console in an old school traditional sense of gross, like just a really bro-y thing, I think Tesla would be good for that. I think Tesla would make like a something shaped like a spaceship. Every app on there is somehow edgelordy or something. I don't know.
Or it's like play this game to make out with your lady.
Right. It's called like Le Console, and it's got like Pepe on it.
The Grimes branded $1 billion vanity project that's just called like a bad version of Call of Duty, except like, you know, it has her doing sound effects. I don't know. I imagine like an RC car that transforms into a console, that an RC car that looks like a Tesla that like you have to charge in a charging station, and that you can like transformer it up into a console.
Yeah, and you can slot the car into your existing actual Tesla car. It's got like a little home in there where you can put it in for no reason.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking about like military hardware contractors, like just put Blackwater and stuff. A bunch of Call of Duty games.
Basically already happening.
Yeah. Yeah, they're already kind of connected with each other. I mean, there's no way that I guess it would be funny, like, if you imagine people who are like military, who are pure military, who don't have like game development experience, and that they like didn't even try to hire game developers to make something, and it's just like the most bizarre approximation of what they think a fun game would be. That would be pretty funny.
It's all just like drone simulator.
Well, everyone's trying to make Ender's Game in real life, and yeah. It's happening.
It's the last Starfighter, baby.
Who loves it? Nobody.
I would like to continue a conversation we started before the show and talk about then-contemporary console games, which were never officially sanctioned by the console makers. Were any of them good, or were they all shovelware?
We're talking about, like, what we would call unlicensed games on a system, right?
Yeah.
I remember playing Micro Machines for NES. I had the gold cartridge. I remember liking that game.
Yeah. You know, Codemasters, they were Codemasters. They were all right. That was probably their best game on the system. Tengen was literally Atari. They just didn't, you know, want to work with Nintendo on license. So, you know, those games are all at least competent, the Tengen stuff.
They had a Gauntlet port, I think. I remember playing that one.
Yeah, Gauntlet was fine. Gauntlet 2 is a little better, even. They have a pretty good Pac-Mania, if that's your kind of game. So, I mean, that's like base level stuff. But that said, I'm really interested in sort of the weird international stuff that that was made on the NES that can be really interesting. So one of my favorite games on the system is out of Korea, and it's called Magic Kid Goo Goo. And it's something that...
Tell us about this.
It's something that, you know, if you're just looking at it, you're like, you know, lol, cheap, weird game. But it's like, no, these... I mean, Brandon, were you at the GDC thing when we played this?
I was.
Okay, yeah. So it's a two-player... It can be a two-player game that's essentially Mario 2 at its core, in that you pick up things to throw them at enemies, except that you do have a timer when you pick things up. So, like, you pick it up, and no matter what, if 5 seconds pass, they just throw it no matter where you are on the screen. So that makes for some really interesting, you know, puzzle mechanics in terms of, like, what, you know, how do I accomplish the goal I need, knowing that he's just going to throw this thing no matter where I am in 5 seconds.
Sounds like a good way to deal with item hoarding.
Yeah, well, yeah. And also, this is a game with, like, item hoarding to, like, go into the pause menu and power yourself up in all kinds of weird and interesting ways. And we had a screaming good time at GDC playing this game that was only ever made and sold in Korea for the Nintendo. So nothing about being a Nintendo licensee makes you better at video games.
Right.
This only, like, partially counts, but I remember when I had, like, a online semi-friend from, you know, community, like, you know, years ago, I talked to him on MSN, who was from Argentina, and he said, like, one of his favorite games was Super Mario Brothers 4, which was, you know, like a game, you know, it was like a hacked game, you know, released only in that region in South America. And it's the original game is called Armadillo.
I was about to ask if it was Armadillo. Yep.
Yeah. And like, that game is actually really interesting. The original, maybe more so than it hacked, because Mario rolls into a ball. And that's, yeah, it's the same game, I guess. But I don't know. There are a lot of, like, very particular experiences where people are like, wow, that was a really important part of my childhood or whatever. And it's completely, like, completely hacked other game.
Yeah, I was talking to some folks in Poland at one point, and everybody was reminiscing about this game. I was like, what game is this? And I'm like, oh, yeah, we all had it on the Pegasus. And I couldn't figure out what game it was. And then I was at, like, a video game bar that they had in Warsaw, and then someone was like, oh, they've got it, here it is. And it was just Contra. it just had a different name. Everyone knew it by this other name that wasn't Contra.
That's very good.
What was it, like, a Polish name?
No, it was you know, it was like Super Fighter Extreme or something weird, like,
okay,
that.
Okay.
Yeah,
because I know it's called, like, Probotector or something in certain parts of
Europe. Contra, not a fairly controversial name during during that period.
Oh yeah.
I mean, like, I'm just trying to think of games outside of the NES, because that's mostly my thing. Brandon, there's got to be some interesting stuff on the Genesis, right?
Yeah, so on Genesis, there's all kinds of games from Taiwan. There are some, interestingly, the only two games that use Final Fantasy style action time, active time battle, whatever that's called.
ATB.
ATB meters are both games from Taiwan. And that's pretty interesting. It's really interesting to me to look at these games, because some of them are clearly just like cash-ins. There's a game called General Yang Family or something like that, that it's really like Capcom's Knights of the Round, but more boring and on the Genesis. And those are just, you know, they're fine. They're whatever. If you want to play a beat 'em up for a long time and kind of fall asleep, it's good for that. But a lot of the RPGs are really like, they're just made from the ground up, and they're totally different games that you wouldn't have gotten anywhere else. They're not hacks of anything. They're not trying to be something else. It's just like, we made this entire RPG on the Genesis, and here it is.
There's a company in China, I don't know how to pronounce it. It's Waixing. And they've done something like 60 RPGs, just original RPGs on the Famicom in Chinese.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really interesting.
Great. On the TurboGrafx and TurboGrafx CD, there was Games Express, which did Strip Fighter 2, which was like a porn fighting game. But when you stack up the actual fighting game against other fighting games on the platform, it's not worse than them. it's not a great, like, it's not as good as this amazing Street Fighter 2 Championship Edition port, but, like, it's good. It's weird.
All right, good talk. Can realistic human jumping be fun in a video game?
If Bennett Foddy did it, probably.
Yeah, I like that answer.
If you made it into like a clumsy and funny thing, like as a subversion of expectations or something,
It makes me think of the mechanic at the beginning of Another World where you got to stomp on the bugs, mm-hmm. and it's kind of like a realistic stomp, and you really have to wait till they're close and it's awkward. So it'd probably be something like that, where it's just a lot of really precise jumps. Like, what I'm imagining is Cannibalt, but like your timing is crazy precise on the jumping because you just don't jump very high or far.
Well, there could be a sim element where you have to like manage if you break your ankle or like injure yourself, or if you have like you have to manage all aspects of your injury.
Yeah, this was what I was going to kind of talk about, which is I make fun of, you know, Nathan Drake's unlimited stamina in Uncharted. He's like the best climber in the universe. He can climb in it. He never gets tired. But if there were a game where, you know, jumping and running was a central pillar of the game and you got tired and you had to like go to sleep for 8 hours because we're really going realistic, I would not enjoy the jump getting shorter and shorter over time until you decide to stop playing. That sounds tiresome to engage with, even to me. But I could also see it being interesting.
Unless it's a funny game where the point is to like injure yourself, or
yeah.
or like what ways can you torture yourself in the game? I mean, you could make a engaging and entertaining game out of that, I suppose.
There was a mod a few years ago called Normal Mario Brothers, where it was a recreation of Super Mario Brothers, but you could only jump like the height that a human can jump. And it was about like avoiding all enemies. It just made like every Goomba like a boss encounter. It's pretty cool.
But Mario didn't get tired, I assume.
No. I guess there's also sports games, like jumping in a basketball game or in even like Tony Hawk.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's the answer for what exists now is sports games are somewhat realistic, and also the stats, the things that the jumps that people are able to make in the basketball games.
Maybe not in NBA Jam, but no. maybe in some Jam. other games, yeah.
Yeah, in that 2K, for example. They're jumping according to their actual height stats and what they can really do in real life.
I wonder if in these games they do let people jump just a little bit more than they could just to make it a video game.
Yeah, I would.
That would be interesting to explore.
That's like a good GDC talk.
Yeah.
Go to. I wouldn't go to. I would look at it and go, ooh, I should go to that. That sounds fun. And then I wouldn't go to it.
Right.
Yeah. That's what you do with GDC talks. Is you, yeah. You're like, oh. All right.
I'd like to enrich myself and learn, and then you just get tired.
Yeah.
That's exactly why they haven't done it, because I bet somebody submitted it, and they're like, and somebody who was approving it was like, oh, I'd go to that, and then forgot about it.
You ask someone else, hey, did you go to that talk? And they're like, nah.
It's always fun at GDC when you get someone who's like bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and they're like, hey, so what good talks did you see? And you're like, oh, man, I haven't seen anything. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm just here trying to stay
good
alive.
Good talks? What is that? I've never heard of that.
Yeah, that's almost an oxymoron.
I've carved out time for exactly this one. What do you want, kid?
Yeah, that's right. There's this one that's a postmortem of a game from 20 years ago that I enjoy.
Yeah, I'm going to enrich myself and better my craft by going to this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Familiar things only, please. I just had to readjust all the jumps in Gunsport, and that was interesting. They're not human-oriented jumps because Gunsport characters are cybernetically augmented. But, it was an interesting experience just because... So people didn't really like the jumps in Gunsport originally, and I understand where they're coming from, because I didn't prioritize good feeling jump. I prioritized ability to aim and fire at a ball while jumping and falling over good feeling jump, because my thinking was people who got good at this game would want to have such control over where and how they do things. Like in this game, you're trying to shoot a ball into a goal, that they would really want to have a lot of fine control in the air. So you also have the ability to, like, the longer you hold the button, the higher you jump. And I think all of those things contributed to making the jump just feel bad. And what I should have realized is that, you know, it's not like my game was going to be the next big esport and people were going to figure all that stuff out. Really, what I needed to do was make the jumps feel good, and then they would figure out how to do fancy trick shots and stuff and get good at it that way.
Brandon, maybe you should have just made a volleyball game.
Yeah, you know, that would have been a good idea.
Extreme gun volleyball.
Yeah.
What if you could shoot each other? That's what everybody said when they played that game.
That's your tagline.
Yeah, we thought of it.
Who's the Christopher Columbus of video games?
You don't mean the guy who sailed to America by accident, or do you?
I mean the Cristobal Colon, that guy.
You mean the person who takes credit for work done and pioneered by other people? Like how many people do we have that fit into that category?
Yeah, exactly.
A lot.
I think Nolan Bushnell probably deserves a lot of credit, but he's the one that comes to mind for me, mostly because I've seen him do a public talk twice, and both times he talked about how he personally hired Steve Jobs and like mentored him, and like all these memories that he has of Steve Jobs. And as far as we know, they barely interacted. So I'm guessing it's he's one of them.
The reason for my confusion was because of the relatively famed director of Home Alone and Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, etc.
That's Chris Columbus.
He does go by Chris, but I think he was born.
But his mom might call him Christopher.
Yeah.
Like when she's mad, like Christopher, Christopher Columbus.
He's going to direct the Five Nights at Freddy's movie, which is
an angry New York Jewish mom.
Christopher Columbus.
So I guess that makes Scott Cawthon the Chris Columbus of video games.
That's right.
Who runs EA? Who's the EA guy everyone hates? Are there multiple EA guys that everyone hates?
Some Trump cabinet guy, I think.
Oh, okay.
I don't know who runs EA today. I have no idea.
Andrew Wilson, according to Google.
Who's the one who like took a bunch of ideas from Bethesda and then made the Madden games out of it? I can't remember that whole story. EA supposedly took the code that Bethesda had made for some football game and then like fired them, or the project didn't work out, and then just used that as the basis for the entire Madden series without compensating Bethesda, who originally, and not that Bethesda's hurting for money.
Isn't Bobby Kotick getting like a $150 million bonus or something like that?
Right? Yeah. 154, I believe.
Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know if it's exactly.
Yeah, but he's not claiming credit other than, I guess, the money part, right? Like I did this. Sure.
He's gaining credit. Like, why does he deserve $154 million for anything?
I mean, probably the closest person to Nolan Bushnell is like probably like Bill Gates, honestly.
Yeah, but does he claim credit for the Xbox? Like, I feel like he's always been.
Well, it's more like PC gaming and gaming as a platform on the PC, and that being a thing that they supported and then didn't. I don't know. Yeah, I guess I think that Nolan Bushnell is the best answer.
Oh, wait, this is too obscure, so it kind of invalidates itself that way. But Tim, what's his name? The Edge guy.
Oh, yeah, Tim.
What is his
name?
Was
it Lindquist?
Mm.
Or is that someone else?
Who's the Edge guy? Well, whoever the Edge guy was.
No, it's not Lindquist. Sorry. That's some other Tim that I've maybe have.
No, that's the Amerigo Vespucci of video games.
I know who the Christopher Columbus of video game music is.
Oh, yeah?
That's our friend Tommy Tallarico.
Detail.
Wait, does he lift other people's compositions?
Tim Langdale.
Tim Langdale, thank you. I was close with the L and D.
You were.
Yeah.
You were.
Okay.
It's more like the video games live stuff, but anyway.
Ah, okay, okay. Yeah.
Oh, there's that guy who claimed to be deaf, who I've talked about on the show before, claimed to be deaf and also claimed to write the Resident Evil soundtrack, and neither of those things were true.
Oh, Mamoru Samaguchi or something like that?
Mamoru Sakuraguchi, something like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, that guy's pretty good, but he didn't like, no genocides happened as the result of his mistake, and so I don't think we have that here in video games at all.
Yeah, I mean, Nolan Bushnell did treat his employees very badly, so yeah, I guess that's the closest thing.
Yeah, I don't think video games quite have the power to create a genocide of an entire people. Just yet. Maybe if we hold out hope.
Yeah.
They could certainly play a role.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We can draw some lines from Gamergate.
Maybe when we get those video game controlled drones finally fine tuned, then whoever did that can be the Christopher Columbus.
Once we get that Grumman box up and running. Here is my lightning round this week. We're playing a game I call Glitchfork Reviews. I'm going to name a video game soundtrack, and you're going to give me a short review of that soundtrack.
What is the glitch part?
As though we are Pitchfork or just
It's like a play on Pitchfork.
Because it's like games and glitch. Yeah,
I mean, just like, do we need to be hipstery about it? Or should I?
Yes, you do.
You absolutely do need to be hipstery.
Do we need to give it like an 8.1 or a whatever, like Pitchfork? Like, you know. Okay.
You got it. You're on the ball here, Liz. All right. Your first soundtrack is Bastion.
I don't remember what it sounds like. I guess that's my review.
Yeah.
It's too much sad piano and violin. I don't actually remember exactly what it sounds like. I just remember
the talking was really innovative, but the soundtrack was left me wanting 6.3.
Yeah, I would say I'd say 6.1.
6.2, actually.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Journey.
It won. It got nominated for an Oscar, or won an Oscar, and
two.
So it absolutely gets a 2 out of 10.
It also misses the real underground sound of the Vincent Diamante tracks they used in their early days.
No songs by the band Journey. So that's an extra strike against.
Right. Missed opportunity. Yeah.
Animal Crossing: New Horizons.
I don't actually know that soundtrack.
It's really boring. It's really boring.
Okay, we'll say boilerplate Nintendo, some cutesy sounds, not their best work, really reminiscent of past faded glory.
9 out of 10.
It's like drinking a LaCroix and imagining what the flavor of raspberry could taste like without actually tasting it. And that, I felt personally insulted because of that, so we'll say 4.9.
Nice.
Shovel Knight.
It's by Vert, so 0.0.
Nice.
Wow. Over-reliance on nostalgia, I feel, as well.
Yeah. Persona 4.
Persona 4.
There's edgy music, I'm sure. Good mix of styles. I don't actually know what it sounds like.
I don't remember what four sounds like. I thought we would do 5 because it's like everyone discovering jazz for the first time. Can we change it to 5?
If you want, Brandon, I'll allow it, but I will subtract a point from your total.
I've never listened to jazz, so this is great. 8.3. Best new music.
Yeah, best new genre.
Mega Man 2.
Good soundtrack, not the best Mega Man soundtrack. 8.4. Okay. 8.7. We'll say 8.7.
Nice.
Letting Liz go on that one.
Celeste.
It's fine.
But you have to expand it's fine into like 10 paragraphs.
I can feel the journeys of climbing and ascending the mountain. I can feel the depressions, but also nostalgic, but also too reliant on nostalgia, but also not offensively nostalgic. So we'll say 7.5.
Banjo-Tooie.
A lot of innovative use of aggressive soundscapes. Sampling is really, really innovative here, and it's unclear who it's for and what age group it's targeting, and so I find that incredibly engaging, and it's a 9.8.
Wow. This is the new Fiery Furnaces, the Banjo-Tooie soundtrack, so look that up.
Your last soundtrack is Street Fighter 2.
Well, you know, it's common for everyone to like this, and you know, but I personally don't think it's what's her name's best work. I think that, you know, the SNES especially sound really muffled, and you know, I just really think I really don't think other people, I think their nostalgia is taking over, and I'm just gonna say 3.2.
Thanks.
I had to have the hipster contrarian take in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
You absolutely nailed this terrible exercise, and I'm going to have to give you the win for this whole episode for it. Congratulations, Liz. Your prize is homework.
Okay. I hope no one who actually is involved with any of those things listens and takes my critique seriously.
Yeah, don't take offense to these.
We're not making fun of you. We're making fun of Pitchfork.
That's right.
And if you're someone from Pitchfork who listens to this, I'm sorry all our conceptions of you come from the year 2010.
Oh, I was making fun of Banjo-Tooie, though.
Yeah. Grant Kirkhope, if you're listening to this, do better.
I like the Banjo-Kazooie soundtrack, but I don't know about Banjo-Tooie. Banjo-Tooie is a retread. Right. 5.0.
This is the point where we recommend stuff to people and possibly plug what we're working on if we feel inclined to do that as well.
That's right. I didn't do anything this time around. That's the problem. Same. I do have one, which is the Ace Combat 3 soundtrack, which I think you should listen to all the way through.
Yeah.
Because it's got so much weird stuff in it. And it's like, you're listening to it and it's like, okay, this is some generic electronic music. And then later it's like, what is this, a horror game? Is this a game where I'm supposed to feel sad about my dead mom? Like, what kind of a game is this? And it rules just all the way through as you're listening. It feels like there are a bunch of emotional beats that they were trying to hit, but you're just a plane flying around shooting stuff. Like, what? Why did they make that soundtrack for this? So that's my recommendation. Listen to that.
Where am I listening to that?
Oh, just on YouTube.
Okay.
Also listen to Liz's music mixes. Where can we do that? Because I always enjoy them.
Oh yeah. I have them uploaded on YouTube. I think they're called different things. They're called like
You got a few series.
I used to run a Tumblr called Sounds from the Abyss, and that's what it extended out of. I think the first one is called The Digital Abyss. The second one is called The Digital Void. The third one is called the I don't know. They held different names. I'll give you the link to like the playlist that has all four of them on them.
Yeah, please drop the links in our chat, and I'm sure Esper will include them in the show notes.
Yes, and you can download MP3s for I think the first three of them. I never put the fourth download up there, but maybe I should. But anyway, those are for strange game music. I don't even know what strange. The definition of strange has expanded. It's basically just like moods/vibes that I think are interesting at this
More
point.
Than strange, it's like singular, like something that doesn't sound like other stuff. And so listening to those, it's a good experience. And the reason we were talking about Ace Combat 3 was like, you should listen to this soundtrack if you haven't. And she was like, oh yeah, I put some of those tracks into some of my mixes, which reminded me that those mixes are good. So there you go.
I'm going to recommend sleep and water. Those are both real good things to give yourself. I do a lot of sleeping. I do like 9 hours a night. I'm drinking water all day. I don't know that necessarily I'm like, wow, before all this, I was this and now I'm this. Because I don't know. I've just always kind of had that habit.
Of drinking water? That's good.
Yeah, that too. I don't know. I'm seeing people tweeting about how like, man, once you hit 27, it's like you get hurt. You're just like aching all the time. It's like, what is wrong with you people? And all I can figure is that no one's drinking water or sleeping.
Well, sleeping isn't necessarily that easy to do depending on a variety of factors.
True. For you, yeah, I know you have some issues with that. Yeah.
I mean, I'm one of those people who my body started aching immediately when I turned 27. So
nice.
That was due to lack of exercise.
Okay. Do some of that too then.
Yeah. Exercise is good. Do stretching. Stretch. Remember to stretch. I would like to recommend, I don't think I mentioned this before, but my actual favorite YouTuber who talks about video games, and I know this is a cursed category, is this guy. It's called Ross's Game Dungeon, and he mostly talks about like old PC games, pretty obscure stuff. He has a few moments that I don't like, you know, that are like a little iffy, but I would skip his Sonic Heroes episode because that's kind of out of character. But like, he has played a lot of bizarre and interesting PC games, and I think he comes from the context of like somebody who's like a like machinima like let's player. Like, he had these videos called Freeman's Mind, like, that were on YouTube ages ago, where he was like narrating Gordon Freeman's thoughts from Half-Life. Those are okay, but I like his Ross Game Dungeon videos a lot. They're really good, so I recommend those. And I also recommend, what was I going to say? Oh, I did a podcast episode, me and this this guy, Alex Ross, who's like a game academic. We watched through and talked about some documentaries about indie games for my podcast, The Blood Zone. And we're about to record the second one where we talk about those. So the podcast isn't just about that, but if you want to relitigate the past through us watching these documentaries, some of which are kind of obscure, yeah, check out the Blood Zone podcast, which is my kind of sporadically updated podcast.
Sounds great. Terrific supplementary listening to this particular show. I must say. I would also like to make some of my own recommendations. First and foremost, I would like to recommend that if you're listening to the show on any platform where you can subscribe to a review podcast, that you go ahead and do that thing for us. I do read those reviews and it makes me happy to see them. And maybe one day I'll share one or two with you. I didn't think to do it today, but maybe next time. You can also go to patreon.com/insertcredit, where you could become a patron to submit your own questions, get our regular episodes one day early.
One day early.
One day early.
One day early. And even access to monthly bonus episodes and other exclusive content. You can also join us on forums.insertcredit.com and follow us on Twitter for our own personal updates and projects. The show is at Insert Credit. I'm at Alex Jaffe. Frank is at Frank Cifaldi. Brandon is at Necrosofty. And Liz is at Ella Guro. This show is produced by Esper Quinn with music by Kurt Feldman. Once more, I'm Alex Jaffe.
I'm Frank Cifaldi.
I'm Brandon Sheffield.
And I'm Liz Ryerson.
And your game has now been saved!
Wow.
Wahoo!
Wahoo yippee.
Great. Okay, yeah. I'm gonna stop recording now.
It's great.
Yeah, we got enough material at the beginning. We can stop.
We could get more material if we want to. That's right.